Hello, welcome to another new session of Tech Athena. I hope everyone is doing fine. For those of you who are new to Tech Athena is a platform where we discuss about cutting edge or bleeding edge technologies or technologies which are going to affect your data center or the way you are going to work. So with that, I'm your host Deepti and with me is my co-host Shalaka.
Hey, hi everyone there. Thank you for joining in, guys. As we start the discussion, I mean, first of all, today's little bit of surprise. Our speaker for the day is Deepti herself. She has been reading a lot about containers. So before we start, Deepti, why don't you first of all give us a brief background of, you know, what you have been doing and how you happen to be in the container world.
Okay, so Shalaka, just to give you a background or just to tell everyone, I am not an engineer. I come from a biology background. But yeah, I always used to be on the biology plus technology, and later on I realized that my interest is more towards physics and technology. So that's how I entered into the field of technology. So when I started my career, I started with even IBM products only as a partner, but I started with IBM monitoring products. If you are aware of Tivoli or network monitoring, application monitoring, with those products. And then I moved on to security for a couple of years, and then I moved towards virtualization. That's where I got introduced to the hardware, and then later on I moved on to completed towards hardware and towards storage. And I know about containers. So any storage architect or rather any hardware architect, if they have to design a solution for any application, they need to know what is the solution or what is the application, how the application works. So that's how, like, for example, if I have to design something for VMware, I need to know how VMware works. That's how I can design my architecture of the hardware. So in the same way, that's how I entered into the field of containers. And then I started reading. Of course, I already knew OS quite well. So yeah, containers was just an extension to it.
Okay, so that sort of resolves the mystery of, you know, how a storage person ends up reading about the containers. But now your LinkedIn profile also says that you are a blockchain enthusiast. So I was just curious, how do you think your journey into container will help you in your blockchain journey?
So what is blockchain? It's an application, right? It's the application layer. So ultimately, it has to be installed somewhere. And container actually helps blockchain installation. You can actually install a blockchain application as a different service in different containers. That's how my interest of blockchain and container coincide.
Okay, all right. So let us leave the stage to you, Deepti. Take us through whatever you have to say about containers today and enlighten us with this new, amazing, upcoming kid on the block.
Oh, definitely, Shalaka. I'm sure everyone is going to enjoy today's session. Okay, so let me take you to agenda first. So today's agenda, I'm going to discuss about what is a container, first of all, and then the history of containers, then what type of containers exist, then the networking in containers, and how secure are the containers, and the use cases of where all the containers can be used, those which you already know and those which you are not aware of.
Okay. Sounds exciting.
Okay, so with that, I'll start today's session.
So what is a container? A container is a package that is designed or custom made for an application to work. So if you even see a shipping container, it is a package or a box which is custom designed to carry a particular material or food or anything for the matter of sake. So containers, by definition, are a way to package your application code, configuration, dependencies, runtime into a single object. Containers in IT world, share an operating system installed on a server and run as a resource isolated process to ensure quick, reliable and consistent deployments regardless of the environment. So before I break this definition further more deep, let me explain you the history of containers, which will help you in understanding how these came into origin or what these containers exactly are. So I put together this slide to explain you the container ecosystem evolution, how containers started and with what intention they came into the picture and how they evolved. So with that, 1979 marked the beginning of the containers. I am sure many of us were not even born and a few were very young. So in 1979 is when Unix version 7, which was marked as a true complete version of Unix, was released. So which introduced something called ch root system call or change root system call. Change root system call is a way of changing the root directory of a process and its children to a new location in the file system. This led the beginning of the process isolation, that is segregating file access of each process. And in 1982, BSD operating system added chroot. Nearly two decades later, in 2000, Derek Woolworth, who was then working with a small shared hosting service provider, came up with free BSD jails to achieve clear-cut separation between its services and those of customers for security and ease of administration. So free BSD jails allowed administrators then to partition a free BSD computer system into several independent processes called jails. So later on, in 2001, Linux again came up with something called Linux vServer, which is again a virtualization of operating system. Like free BSD jails, Linux vServer is a jail mechanism that can partition resources on a computer system. This was again added to the Linux through a patch. In 2004 came the Solaris Zones, which then got acquired by Oracle, and now it is called Oracle Solaris Zones. The free public beta of Solaris containers was released in 2004. Which combines system resources control and boundary separation provided by zones, which were able to leverage features like snapshots and cloning using ZFS, which was part of Solaris operating system. And then in 2005 came the Open Virtuoso. This was again a patch to Linux kernel for resource management and migration. In 2006 came the process containers. These were launched by Google, was designed for limiting, accounting and isolating resource usage of a collection of processes. It was later on renamed as control groups a year later and eventually merged into Linux kernel 2.6.24. At the same time in 2007, got released were AIX WPaaS or AIX Workload Partition. Those who are aware of AIX OS, they would know this very well. This was they considered this as the initial days of containers. Then it was a software implementation of OS level virtualization that provides today also application environment isolation and resource control. In 2008 came the LXC, Linux containers, which was the first most complete implementation of Linux Container Manager. It combined control groups and Linux namespaces and it works on a single Linux kernel without requiring any patches. And then in 2011 came the Cloud Foundry with the product called Warden, which was initially using LXC Linux containers in the early stages and later replaced it with its own implementation. Warden could Then isolate environment on any OS running as a daemon and providing API for container management. It first provided the client server model of collection of containers across multiple hosts. It also included a service to manage namespaces, control groups, and process lifecycle. So that marked kind of advancement of the OS containers. In 2013 came the LMCTFY, which meant let me contain that for you. It was an open source version of Google Container Stack, providing Linux application containers. Applications could be made container aware, creating and managing their own subcontainers. This was the beginning of the application containers. Active deployment of LMCTY stopped in 2015 after Google started contributing its code to the concept of libcontainers, which is now part of Docker. And later Google donated its LMCTFY code to Open Container Foundation, which later included the same code into Docker. Then came the Docker. When Docker emerged in 2013, containers exploded in popularity. And people actually consider containers equivalent to Docker. So the word Docker and containers go hand in hand. So just as Warden of Cloud Foundry did, Docker also initially used LXC, Linux containers, but later on it implemented its own code and replaced container manager with its own library called libcontainer. But there is no doubt that Docker separated itself from the pack by offering an entire ecosystem of container management. In 2014 came the Rocket containers, which was part of CoreOS. CoreOS developed them. They actually took all the problems that existed in Docker and built Rocket. CoreOS was later acquired by Red Hat, and then Red Hat got later acquired by IBM. So right now it is with IBM, or rather it is still with Red Hat. Then 2014 also came something called Kubernetes, which was developed by Google for automating deployment, scaling, and management of containerized applications. Rather, we can call it as a container orchestration platform. In 2016 came the Apache Mesos Marathon, which is again a production-grade container orchestration platform. In 2016, another interesting thing that happened was the Windows containers, which got released. So Windows Server containers and Hyper-V containers got released. And 2017 was the rise of containers. Then all the cloud vendors started adopting containers. Each one started coming up with their own container packages. Like Azure came up with their packages, AWS came up with their packages, and then IBM came up with something called ICP. And then came the Kubernetes support for Windows. Kubernetes initially were only supporting Linux, and later on it started supporting even Windows applications to run in Kubernetes. And then after 2017, the evolution of containers just exploded. There were many small startups which developed for networking, for security. And by the way, in 2016 also, the concentration of security on containers came into the picture. So as I go through further slides, I'm going to explain about many such products and in both networking and security. In 2018, I especially kept Istio because Istio became very, very famous. It's an open source service mesh that provided the fundamentals you need to successfully run a distributed microservice architecture. Istio combined a microservices architecture with the containers. Rather, it made it easy for the deployment of containers with the microservices. That's the reason it got quite popular. So this is the brief history about containers. I guess now you might have got a clear idea of what containers are. But I think you might have known so far a lot about OS, heard a lot about OS containers. But today's topic is about application containers. Let me tell you the difference. So what type of containers exist? Many of you might be aware of virtualization. So in a virtualization, you have an infrastructure. You have a hypervisor or a host operating system running on it. And then a hypervisor, and then you install guest OS. Like for example, if you have a host OS of Windows and then you want to run your other versions of Linux, Unix or MS-DOS, then you install a hypervisor and install your guest OS and all the required bins or libraries, and then install application in each virtual machine. So that was the virtual machines. Then containers, there were two types of containers. One is the operating system OS containers, and other one is the application containers. OS containers were actually ancestors of virtualization, or rather you can say hypervisors, like VMware or Citrix. It was ancestor of it. So OS containers, you install your infrastructure, you have your server, and then you have your operating system, and over it you have your container engine, and then you can again partition it to install three different guest OS, and then you install your libraries and your application in each guest OS. Then all the OS funders are thinking is, why do we have to install guest OS? Can't my applications be just be containerized? So that's when came the revolution of application containers, where you have infrastructure, then you have one operating system, and then you have a container engine or a daemon, and then you partition the OS to install as a separate partition which has its own networking, which has all the application libraries, all the file system layers, everything needed for a particular application. So you no more have to spend any more on the OS for installing a different application, different applications in the, or at the different containers within the same host or within the same server. So right now I had, when I was explaining about history, I explained about many products. So of which LXE, OpenVZ or Solaris Zones, BSD Jails and Linux vServer, which you heard, are all OS containers. And application containers are only Docker and Rocket. These are meant to run as a single service, and they have layered file system. These are built on top of a OS container technology. So actually Docker and Rocket can also be installed on VMs. While OS containers are meant to be used as an OS run multiple services, no layered file system by default. Then they have built-in control groups, namespaces, native process resource isolation. So this is about types of containers. So as our session is about application containers, and the king of application containers is Docker. So I'm going to discuss further more details about Docker.
So let us understand the Docker architecture in detail. Docker uses a client-server architecture. Docker client talks to Docker daemon, which does the heavy lifting of building, running and distributing your Docker containers. Docker client and daemon can run on the same system, or you can connect a Docker client to a remote Docker daemon. The Docker client and daemon communicate using a REST API over a Unix socket or a network interface. Then let's see Docker daemon much more in detail. So Docker daemon, if anyone has used Docker, you would know there's something called Docker D. Daemon actually listens for Docker API requests and manages Docker objects such as images, containers, like you can see in the picture, images, containers, networks and volumes. A daemon can also communicate with other daemons to manage Docker services. And what is a Docker client? A Docker client is a primary way that many Docker users interact with Docker. When you use commands such as Docker run, the client sends the commands to the Docker daemon, which is Docker D, which carries them out. Docker command uses Docker API to communicate with Docker daemon. And then what is a registry? A Docker registry stores Docker images. Docker Hub is a public registry that anyone can use. And Docker is configured by default to look for images in the Docker Hub. You can even run your own private registry. If you use Docker Data Center Edition, it includes Docker Trusted Registry, which is more secure than using a public registry. When you use Docker pull or Docker run commands, the required images are pulled from your configured registry. When you use Docker push command, your images are pushed into the configured Docker registry. So in a Docker host, you also have, along with Docker daemon, you have something called Docker objects. Docker daemon manages the objects. Those objects are containers and images. Images actually are a very crucial part of and Docker, and that's what makes Docker very unique. An image is a read-only template with instructions for creating Docker container. Often an image is based on another image with some additional customizations. You might create your own image, or you might use you might only use those created by others and published in the Docker Hub or in the registry or in your own private registry. To build your own image, you create a Docker file with a simple syntax for defining the steps needed to create the image. Each step in the Docker file is considered as a different layer. When you change the Docker file and rebuild the image, only those layers which have changed are rebuilt. So if you have read before, you might have heard the Docker uses something called copy on write. So that's what happens here. Instead of rebuilding the whole image, it will only, when you make a new similar image, right, it will only change the layers and do a snapshot, copy on write. This is the part that makes images so lightweight, small and fast when compared to the other virtualization technologies. That's the reason Docker has got very famous, because it's quite lightweight on your OS. And then what are containers? A container is a runnable instance of an image. You can create, start, stop, move or delete container using Docker API or CLI. You can connect a container to one or more networks attached to a storage, or even create a new image based on its current state. By default, a container is relatively well isolated. All the network features, services, anything that you want to assign to the container is something that you have to give. So container is an isolated system that you make for your application, or rather you customize it for your application. A container is defined by its image as well as any configuration options you provide to it when you create or start it. When a container is removed, any changes to its state that are not stored in the persistent storage disappear. So this is a very big problem in container world. So there is also, if you are reading about Docker, you will also come across something called services, which is provided by Docker Swarm. I am not discussing that in detail because we have another session on container orchestration where we'll be talking about Docker Swarm, Kubernetes and all in detail. I also wanted to briefly explain you in detail about the underlying technology behind the Docker. A Docker is written in a language called Go and takes advantage of several features of Linux kernel to deliver its functionality. For example, like namespaces. Docker uses a technology called namespaces to provide isolated workspaces called container. When you run a container, Docker creates a set of namespaces for that container. These namespaces provide a layer of isolation. Each aspect of a container runs in a separate namespace and its access is limited to that namespace. For example, if you have seen in Linux, there's PID namespace, net namespace, IPC, or for mount you have MNT, that's a separate mount namespace as well, and then UTS. UTS is for Unix time sharing. And Docker also has something called control groups.
which I, when I discussed about the history, I told you about it. Docker engine on Linux also relies on a technology called control groups. A control group limits an application to a set of resources. Control groups allow Docker engine to share available hardware resources to a container and optionally enforce limits and constraints. For example, you can limit a memory available to a specific container. And another interesting thing is the union file system, the file system which the Docker uses. It is called UnionFS or Union File System. Are file systems that operate by creating layers, making them very lightweight and fast. That is what is called, uses copy on write. Docker engine uses UnionFS to provide the building blocks of the container, that are the images. Docker engine can use multiple union file system variants like AUFS, BTRFS, VFS and device mapper. And another thing is about container format. Docker engine combines namespaces, controller groups and union file system into a wrapper called container format. The default container format is libcontainer. You might have heard about libcontainer, right? Docker donated this libcontainer to OCI, Open Container Initiative, so that it can be built by the public and it's open to everyone to improve it. In 2017, Docker gave Containerd project to Cloud Native Computing Foundation. Containerd is an industry standard container runtime that leverages RunC and was created with an emphasis on simplicity, robustness and portability. Containerd is the core container runtime of Docker engine. So actually I'm not going in deep, but if you have time you should also inquire little bit more about Containerd and libcontainers. In fact, you can also reach me out. I can give you a further more details or give you a proper deck on Containerd alone. So this is the picture, this picture shows how what we already explained, how an external client communicates with the Docker daemon through REST API. Containers, images, data volumes, network, which are the objects which communicate through CLI or client through a REST API to server daemon to reach the OS. So far we have understood the detailed internals or details of the Docker containers. So I thought Rocket and Docker are the two application containers that are available, and Rocket Core OS guys, they claim that they have developed Rocket taking the deficiencies of Docker into consideration. So I thought, let me put the differences between Docker and Rocket. So container standards used by Docker are Open Container Initiative standards, and Rocket uses the APC or application container standards. And a container runtime used by Docker is RunC libcontainer, and now they are also using Containerd. Rocket uses something called RKT. And container management, Docker has Docker engine, which has a Docker daemon, Docker client. While this is the main difference of the Rocket, that is Rocket only has a Rocket CLI and it has no daemon, that is here daemon talks right directly to the root in Docker. So so if an attacker attacks a particular container through an application, then he has access to the root, that is through that he can actually access all other containers or the complete host and destroy it. While in Rocket, the container runs as a sub process under the main process. So there is no way an attacker can get to the root. So if he attacks, it will only be that container that will get attacked and not the other containers. So that's what Rocket claims. They are different. While Docker says that instead of installing as a super user, why don't you install using SC Linux? But many of the server admins find it very difficult to install Docker using SE Linux because the steps involved, hence they end up installing as a super user. Then container definition, Docker containers are built using image files or the Docker file, which is a customized image that you build instead of using a pre-built image. And Rocket uses application container image. Registries, Docker has a Docker registry. You can create your own registry, private registry, or use a data center edition where you can build a very secure trusted registry. Or use a public registry, but usually public registry images are prone to attack, so many organizations avoid it. Rocket doesn't have anything like that, so that's where Rocket says they're again secure enough. And OS used by Docker is a Docker machines or the host OS itself, while Rocket uses something called Core OS. So this is the basic difference between both the application containers in the market. So it's up to you which you want to try. I would say try both of them and then make a decision. And Docker being more popular, there are many security and a lot of development that has come across Docker. So in that way, it's up to you to decide which way you want to go. So another interesting thing which when I started learning about containers was I used to hear a lot in the market about containers can be moved anywhere, containers can be moved to the cloud, to another computer. The flexibility with the containers is that unlike a VM where you will have to also install the OS if you have to move the VM. So, and they say VM are very difficult to move unlike containers. So I thought, let me explain you the different networking aspects of container and how container connects to the external world, or how, why container is considered easier to move anywhere. First of all, you already have seen how light the container is and how easy it is to move. Now you need to understand how the networking aspects of container is unlike a VM. This is a picture which shows a basic outline of any container network. I have taken Docker networking into consideration here. So user connects through services or apps, and there's service discovery engine or orchestration engine where app, Mesos, Kubernetes, Nomad or Docker Swarm are there. And then comes the Docker networking, where you have two kinds of networking, where single host networking, that is networking within the host itself, and multi-host networking, that is networking between the containers and different hosts, or containers on cloud or in different locations. So I'm going to explain further more detail in the coming slides. And then how these networking aspects or different networking methods connect to the hardware and then to the external networking world. So that is through that is low level networking through namespace, routing or IP VLAN, and then they connect to the hardware. So this is in short or in brief about how the networking happens. Now I'm going further more detail into single host networking and multi host networking in my further slides. This picture shows how a container connects in a single host. As you're already aware of the discussion we had so far, every Docker container has a Docker client, daemon and registry. Daemon coordinates between the registry and the client, or daemon talks to the container. It starts, stops and inspects the container. And the relationship between the container and the host is 1:1n, that is one host and multiple containers. Basically, in a single host networking boils down to either using shared volume to share the data across, or you share the data across a network. Data volume in a Docker is simple to use. It also needs tight coupling, meaning that it will be difficult to turn a single host deployment into multi-host deployment later. Hence, it is important to decide whether you want to go with single host deployment or to go with multi-host deployment in the beginning itself. Docker networking is native container software defined networking solution that you have at your disposal. In a single host container network, there are four basic modes. First and default mode is the bridged mode. Docker daemon creates Docker Zero, a virtual Ethernet bridge that automatically forwards packets between other network interfaces that are attached. By default, the daemon then connects all containers on a host to this internal network by creating a pair of interfaces. Assigning one of the pair, or rather peers, to the containers as ETH0 and another in the namespace of the host, as well as assigning an IP address or subnet from the private IP range to the bridge. As I already told, bridge mode in the Docker is default. So this happens within the same broadcast domain, and bridge mode can have IP tables. It allows a micro segmentation. So another mode in the single host mode is networking mode is host mode. This mode helps container to share the networking namespace of the host. Containers will use host IP address or host port space. So there's no automatic IP tables for containers here. So like if a company wants to use DHCP for containers, they cannot use it because containers and the host share the same IP address on the ports. As container shares networking namespace of the host, it is directly exposed to the public network, hence there might be security issues. So explicit address or port assignment is required in the host mode case. Then third mode is the Mac VLAN bridge mode, which is a layer 2 mode. Containers interact with the network as if they are independent systems. Host does not have network access to the containers via bridge. Host has to use alternative interface for connectivity, no IP tables here, as this happens on the L2 layer, that is a data link layer. And the fourth and important one, which is used by many people, is IP VLAN L3 mode. That is, it works on the L3 layer, the network layer, where the routing happens. So containers can reach each other even on different subnets as long as they are on the same interface. Host interface acts as a route interface, but no route advertisement. IP tables can be used in this mode. I forgot to mention, in a Mac VLAN mode, the biggest issue is a MAC address. So there has to be a separate MAC address that has to be assigned to each container and even the host. So some ports or some switches, they have a number of MAC address limitation, or some people put a security in their organization to limit the number of MAC addresses. In such cases, this third mode becomes a problem. That's the reason people prefer IP VLAN mode or L3 mode, which is more open and more flexible for them to use. And so these are the four modes in a single host or within the single host for containers. Coming to the multi-host networking environment, multi-host is mostly considered when one host is insufficient to host containers, or when one wants to employ distributed services like Apache Spark, HDFS or Cassandra. But in case of a multi-host environment, there are two things which you need to keep in mind, which are very critical to a multi-host environment. That is the performance and security. So as there are multiple hosts, the communication adds to the latency. Plus, how secure is the data which is being communicated is also becomes quite important. By default, Docker has something called overlays. In March 2015, Docker acquired the software-defined startup called Socketplane and rebranded it as Docker Overlay Driver. This is by default for multi-host networking environment in Docker since 1.9 version onwards. The Overlay Driver extends the normal bridge mode by a peer-to-peer communication and uses a pluggable key-value store backend to distribute the cluster state of the host. Another important one is Flannel, which is by CoreOS. CoreOS Flannel is a virtual network that gives a subnet to each host and used with the container runtimes. Then another important and very popular one is Weaveworks Weave. It creates a virtual network that connects Docker containers deployed across multiple hosts. Applications use the network just as if containers were all plugged into same network switch, with no need to configure port mappings and links. And another interesting project is Project Calico. This is developed by Metaswitch, a company called Metaswitch. So Metaswitch's Calico uses standard IP routing. To be precise, it uses a BGP protocol. The networking tools to provide a layer 3 solution. So this works on layer 3. In contrast, most other networking solutions like Weave build an overlay network by encapsulating layer 2 traffic into higher layer. So there are three more interesting multi-host networking solutions, which a few of which you might be aware of right now. Open vSwitch. Open vSwitch is a multi-layer virtual switch designed to enable network automation through programmatic extension while supporting standard management interface protocols such as NetFlow, IPFIX, LACP and 802.1AG. In addition, it is designed to support distribution across multiple physical servers, quite similar to VMware's vNetwork distributed vSwitch or Cisco's Nexus 1000V. Another very popular one is OpenVPN. OpenVPN is another OSS project that has commercial offering. Allows you to create a virtual private network using TLS handshake. These VPNs can also be used to securely connect containers to each other over the public internet. Then another interesting project is Pipework. Pipework was created by Jerome Petazzoni. He is a well-known Docker engineer and promises to be software-defined networking for Linux containers. Pipeworks lets you connect containers in arbitrary complex scenarios using control groups and namespaces, and works with both LXC or Linux containers as well as a Docker. That is, it works with both OS containers and application containers. So these are the few interesting multi-host networking options which I found, which I thought I would share with you. Apart from this, Kubernetes, Istio, all these also come with networking solutions. So when we will be taking a container orchestration session, then we'll be covering or explaining you the networking using Kubernetes or rather Docker Swarm, etc. So this is the networking portion of it. These are the companies which I felt I should share because they're quite popular and they're being deployed everywhere. There are many more startups which are still coming in. So this is an ever-growing area, and quite a lot of research is going on containers at this point of time. Coming to another very crucial point in the container world, that is containers and the security and their security. I have list down top 5 security concerns of the containers. The research in container security started since 2016, because once people started using them and they started realizing all the loopholes within the containers. So that's when the discussion around container security started. So these are the top 5 points to consider when you are considering container as a strategic initiative. First, the DDoS attacks. Containers share kernel resources. So if one container is able to monopolize access to certain resources, it can starve out other containers on the host. This results in denial of service, leaving users unable to access all or part of the system. this issue was there with VMs also when they started, but over a period of time VMs evolved. So eventually even containers are going to evolve, and this issue will be contained and it will be controllable. Then coming to kernel exploits, unlike a virtual machine, the kernel is shared among all the containers and the host. If any attacker compromises your host, the container isolation and security safeguards won't help. And coming to the third point, which is a poisoned images. If an attacker can trick you into running their image, the host and data are at risk. So make sure that the images that are running are updated or are up to date. And this happens especially in case of a Docker Hub, where you can or organizations end up using external images. So that's where you need to be particularly careful. Be careful on what images you're using. That's the reason many organizations are creating a private registry or a trusted registry by themselves instead of trying to use something from outsider or something which is secured or something which is given by a known outsider. Hence, this becomes another very crucial point. Container breakouts. Be aware of potential privilege escalation attacks, where a user gains elevated privileges through a bug in an application code. Breakouts are possible and should be considered when developing a continuity plan. Then compromise credentials. When a container accesses a database or service, it will require an API key or username and password. Attacker that gains access to these will also have access to the service. So having said all these five crucial points, I also want to say that there are many startups that have come which are working very concentrated way on container security. As containers are in the nascent stage of being used, all these issues are there, but I am sure these are all going to be go away, because these were the issues which were there with VMs as well when they started. Hence, this is not something to worry. You need to just understand what is the way around it. In the interest of time, I haven't included the details of all the startups. However, if you do a Google search, you'll get quite a lot of them. And when we discuss about container container orchestration, there also some security features will come into picture. And last but not least, the use cases of a container. The one which is very popular and which everyone knows is the microservices. Containers provide process isolation that makes it easy to break apart and run applications as independent components called microservices. Just to tell you that we are also conducting another session on microservices. As per our plan, it is planned next on May 25th. You can attend that to understand the microservices further more in detail. Another interesting use case of containers is batch processing, which many are not aware. The most popular one is the microservices. People think it is used only for microservices. But it can also be used for batch processing. Package batch processing and ETL jobs into containers to start the jobs quickly and scale them dynamically in response to demand. Then other interesting use case is machine learning. Use containers to quickly scale machine learning models. Machine learning models are built on need, based on the need for training, inference, and also the data for machine learning comes from various sources. So if you are using containers, you can actually run this machine learning containers close to your data sources on any platform. Then hybrid applications. Containers let you standardize how code is deployed, making it easy to build workflows for applications that run between on-premise and cloud environments. And then application migration to the cloud. Those organizations who are slowly trying to move to the cloud or who operate between on-premise and cloud, containers is a very good option, because containers make it easy to package entire application and move them to the cloud without needing to make any code changes. However, I learned that the operating system should be the same no matter where the container is moving. To make it easy, you cannot move a Linux container onto a Windows container. Maybe going forward in the future, even that option might come in. Then coming to platform as a service, use containers to build platforms that remove the need for developers to manage infrastructure and standardize how your applications are deployed and managed. Hence, containers are not just for developers or AI or for batch processing. They are also for those people who want to make their operations easy. They help managing containers becomes easy. Once you hear one other session of ours on container orchestration, then you will understand how the managing of containers has become more and more easy with the container orchestration. The reason we haven't kept container orchestration as a part of this session was because this session was already going too big. So we thought if we add container orchestration, it's going to become too big and you might be bored of it. Hence, we divided into two different sessions. I kept this slide to give you a glance of container market. Since 2015, from the time actual Docker usage started, in 2016 it was 0.25, the market 0.85 the market was. In 2017 it was 17%, and 18 last year was 20%. In 2023 it is expected to grow to 43.52, and this growth is expected to be fueled by increasing number of container orchestration services and container security services deployed in enterprise globally. So as I discussed earlier, as the number of containers being used, there are more and more security features which are coming in. Hence, enterprises also will be accepting them or strategizing to move towards containers. This doesn't mean VMs are going to go away or virtual machines are going to go away. In fact, containers and virtual machines are collaborating to work together. So now containers can be deployed on virtual machines as well. So there are certain applications which are good with VMs, and there are certain applications which are good with containers. However, what I can say is the number of applications which used to go on VMs will decrease and will move towards containers. Hence, there's a division of workload that will happen. But however, VMs are not going to go away. All critical applications will still be using VMs. I feel the one which will be going away or decreasing will be physical servers. So these are the interesting reads or references that I used while making this session. You can always mail me. We can share the PPT with you. We are now open to Q&A.
So we are back to Q&A. I hope you enjoyed the session. I hope I could give you all the interesting details about containers. As this is 1 hour session, so I have stuck to the time. So Shalaka?
Hey Aditi, it was a brilliant session. A lot of learning for myself as well. It was very good to know about the history and how overall containers have really evolved. And also your charts on capturing the popular open source implementations of container as well as software defined networks, that wasn't even insightful. Now, because you come from the storage background, I also wanted to ask you one question about, you know, how do you really manage persistence of data across containers? What do you do?
Actually containers connect to storage in 3 ways. One is using storage plugins, other one is using another container data volume, that is making a container just to store data, and that container will be talking to other containers. And the third one is connecting to host directly, or rather mounting to the host directory itself. So in the second and third case, your host is directly exposed to the container, and there is a chance that your data might get corrupted or might get compromised. So people most usually prefer the ones with the storage plugin, because that is a very secure one. And the popular plugins in the market are, every storage vendor is coming up with the plugins. The most popular which I know or I work on is Spectrum Connect, which is a Ubiquiti, it's a IBM open source project for containers. So IBM later merged on with the product called Spectrum Connect to connect their block or file storage onto the with the containers. So in the same way, EMC also has something called Rexray, and NetApp has something called Trident. Both are again open source projects.
So sometime back I also heard that Kubernetes was defining a standard called as CSR. And it was their way of sort of standardizing across various container runtimes instead of really using the Docker-based PVPVC. What's your take on that? And does IBM portfolio support CSI already, or is there a plan?
Okay, so let me give you a brief about how Kubernetes works. So you have PVC, which is a persistent volume claim, which the user raises, and then the persistent volume gets created, and then it gets mounted onto the container. So there's two way of connecting to the container, two ways. One is using flex volume, which is Kubernetes proprietary, and other one is CSI. So just to give you, I had happened to have a discussion with the development team. Then what I understood is that CSI is developed by Kubernetes, Docker Swarm, and Mesos. So these three together has developed the CSI interface, which is the container storage interface. So tomorrow, the benefit of it is, if an organization is having implementation of Docker Swarm, Kubernetes, or Mesos, they can use the same CSI to connect to all three of them, or rather any container, any orchestration engine in the market. So while a PVC or will is connected using flex volume, PVC will still be there whether you have CSI or flex volume. Flex volume or CSI are the interfaces. So flex volume is proprietary to Kubernetes only. So CSI will make it, will give much more features than what are there right now. So yeah, IBM is working towards it. I think in a quarter or something, you'll have a release of a CSI, in a quarter or two.
Okay. Okay, all right. So, I mean, again, one of the other question I had was around the differentiations that the storage vendors are creating in the market around connectivity via storage into the container platform. So, like, for example, if IBM is having Spectrum Connect, would you be able to highlight if there are any differentiations that the Spectrum Connect will bring when connecting IBM storage to, say, a container environment? Or is it just a different implementation that everybody will have, but it is really a standardized offering? Is there a differentiation?
Right now, actually, I only got introduced to EMC, Rexray, and NetApp Trident, but I don't really know how deep they are. Okay, I know there are also open source projects which they are developing. But so I see only Spectrum Connect right now. So I see that it is very well integrated. And in fact, it's not new, by the way. Spectrum Connect had been there since quite some time. It is not just used for only containers. The same thing is used for VMware, or to connect with VMware, Realize, or even OpenStack.
Okay. So you are saying it connects with VM as well, not just containers.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay. So, which is good, right? I mean, when you really have a standard interface, and you also have different storages basically using pretty much the same abstraction layer to connect into the container environment. So, as your storages change, there is not really a fundamental change that we have in the abstraction layer.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you so much, Dipti. I mean, it was really an insightful session. Before we close, I mean, just a question which is off the track, but we would like you to talk to us about any new thing that you are actually reading, which is which you probably like or want to share with us.
Okay, let me show that to you rather. So yeah, I'm reading a book called Where Wizards Stay Up Late. This is a book on origin of internet. If you want to know how the @rate came into the picture, how the internet was initially developed, or the ARPANET plan came into the picture, and how people slogged behind this worldwide web, this is a book to read. I just started reading. I find it quite interesting because I miss that whole genre. I was quite young or not even born at all. So I'm learning from there. I mean, if you want to know all the basics, or if you like knowing the history of every technology, so this is a book which I am reading right now. So I would suggest you also try it out. It's an interesting book.
What's the name of the book?
Where Wizards Stay Up Late, The Origin of the Internet. So it's written by Kathy Hafner and Matthew Ion, I think. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Sure, Dipti. Thank you so much for your time. And
And everyone, please do subscribe to our YouTube channel. Please support us. And please let us know what all you want to hear from us more. And you can always mail us your questions, or you can leave your questions as a comment. And thank you. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, team. Thank you for joining in. Thank you, everybody, for taking time out on the weekend. And Dipti, thank you very much for the session.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.